I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. We're bringing together experts, thinkers, and leaders, busting myths, sharing stories, and staying connected when Canadians need it the most. We're having unexpected conversations for unprecedented times. Hi, everyone. Today, we are talking with best-selling author and award-winning health reporter and columnist for the Globe and Mail, André Picard. Hi, André. How are you?
Good. Thank you.
Good. It's really good to see you and hear from you. I'm so used to just following you on Twitter and reading everything you write. I'm a big fan. So
thank you.
I really appreciate your voice when it comes to healthcare in this country. I guess we, you know, it'd probably be best to start with COVID, and because you have been following this very closely right across the country. It's an interesting time to be a health reporter, isn't it?
Yes, we, you know, what's that that curse? May you live in interesting times. Very interesting time for me. But, you know, it's kind of something I've been preparing for unofficially for probably four decades now. So it's kind of the culmination of what stuff I've been doing for a long, long time.
Mm. Would you say this is the, you know, I guess you've been writing on health for how long now? You've been with the Globe and Mail since 87.
Yeah, almost 40 years. So I started writing about AIDS in 1981, right around the time AIDS rose to prominence. And so going on 40 years.
Wow. So what are some of the biggest stories in your career that stick out for you? What sticks out for you?
Well, I think AIDS has kind of been the arc of my career. I started writing at the time I was in university at a university paper when AIDS came along. It was very much a political issue rather than a health issue. So I think that's always shaped the way I approach healthcare. I see it as a political, social, as much as medical. So I think AIDS, and I wrote a lot for many years about tainted blood. I wrote a book about tainted blood, followed the inquiry around the country for almost 2 years. So there's some stories like that that have just been with me forever. And the infectious disease, AIDS is one, but I've covered many, many over the years, SARS, Zika, Ebola, COVID, you name it. You know, that's one of the most interesting things to cover is infectious diseases.
Do you learn something new all the time, or like, do you feel like you're always learning, or because you've been doing this for so long, you've kind of seen it all?
No, I think the beauty of this job is you learn stuff every single day, right? So it's fascinating. It never gets boring, and we're lucky.
And now, in the time when you were writing, obviously, about AIDS, there was no social media. There was no, you couldn't reach out to a reporter like we can now with social media. How was the public or your readership when you were writing about AIDS?
Well, I think we had less of a sense of what our readership was, but, you know, papers were all important, right? If people waited till the paper arrived on their doorstep in the morning, and that was very impactful. Now we don't have that. It's very diffuse, right? It's just sort of constant. And I miss that in a way. I miss having, especially when I read about COVID, I'm like, where's the big story of the day? I want something that really gives me a summary. And I think we don't have that anymore. And I think we're worse off for it. We just have all these, you know, tidbits time after time. Every minute there's something going on. And we don't have a sense of what's going on any given day or week. I was saying to someone the other day, I pity the historians in the future, because it's easy to go back. You know, I can go back to stories I wrote in the early 80s, and they're much longer than they are today, and they're more comprehensive. And a historian could look at that and get a sense of what was going on. If you look today, how do you figure out what was important on any given day when it changes every hour? So it's a very different world for journalists.
Yeah, it truly is. And I mean, everybody talks about clickbait so much, right? We live in this world now where it's, you know, we're scrolling so fast and just looking for that. Like, am I going to read André today? What does it say? You know what I mean? As I'm scrolling by. Is that frustrating as a journalist for you?
I don't know. You know, they've had that same accusation forever. Before we had the social media, it was like, oh, you just have inflammatory headlines, right? It's the same thing. We didn't use the term clickbait, but it was the same complaint. But the reality is you have to boil things down. You have to get people's attention. I think what's changed is people have a a shorter attention span because we live in a different world. It's more, you know, busier. We don't have that one moment in the day when you pick up the paper, right? So I think some of those rituals have changed, but I don't think people, I think people have, are spoiled today. They have so much more selection. You know, I read in the morning, I get on the computer early and I read papers from all over the world. I used to have a stack of papers, you know, papers, and now I have the world's at my fingertips. So it's, there's a lot of good in it and there's some bad.
So how do you decide what it is that your focus will be for the day when you're writing?
Well, I'm just a big reader, so I read a lot. Whatever catches my attention. I don't want to, I try to not do everything that everyone else is doing. So if everybody's doing just big story, I try and do a little something different. I focus more on policy, and very few people do that. So I have, in many ways, I have the field to myself because not a lot of people write about policy. So I'm spoiled in that way. I have a lot of choice about what I can write about.
So you're basically on a, you know, an all-day news cycle. You are probably being inundated all day with information. Where do you, you know, how do we simplify it for the average reader? When, like, it's your job to be, you know, always looking at news. I was in television for decades and it was just 24-hour news. I'd get home and watch more news because I lived it and I loved it. How do we answer the simple questions for people as journalists? How do you, you know, like, can I go to the park? Can I, you know, all these simple questions that are really affecting us day to day. How do we boil it down for people so that we keep them safe?
Well, I think we do, and we do a lot of this now, is we call it service journalism, right? So I spent a lot of time, I just wrote 3,000 words worth of answering questions from readers. And I think that stuff is really important. And it was a lot of basic questions about what does a mask do? Where do I buy a mask? How do I put it on? And it's stuff you think, well, it's simple, but it reminds you that people more than anything want really basic information. And we don't always do a good job of that. So I think the papers, even TV has done a good job of that, of doing a lot of this service journalism for people saying, like, here's what COVID is, and here's how to put on a mask, and here's what a second wave means. You know, what's amazing to me as someone who reads a lot of science that suddenly everyone can talk about an epidemic curve, right? It's just part of our kitchen conversation, something that 5 months ago was the lot of scientists. Only scientists and epidemiologists talked about this. Now we all talk about it. Oh, I was watching the Ontario epidemic curve and it's flattening a bit. And that's good. That's, you know, we're becoming more science literate.
Right. And I mean, you're writing for a national paper. We are, you know, we're a country where each province kind of does their own thing when it comes to healthcare. There's so many different rules and regulations and policies like right across. So how do you make it clear for people? Like, you might be writing about something that's happening in Ontario. I'm over here in British Columbia and I'm like, that none of this affects me. There's nobody has been sick for, you know what I mean? Like, how do we understand the urgency of something like COVID-19 in this country? I'm living in a province where we're doing pretty good. So why should I care about the rest of the country?
Yeah, I think the way you do it is, it's a big country. I write for a national paper for a long time. You look for trends, you look for commonalities, and then you look for unusual things. So in this case, we're focusing a lot on Quebec and Ontario because that's where the bulk of the pandemic is happening. And these days, it's Toronto and Montreal. That's what our whole epidemic is now in Canada. So that's where the focus is. But if, you know, if there was 1,000 cases tomorrow in Nova Scotia, we'd focus intensely on Nova Scotia. So you find ways of doing, about writing the big picture by focusing on smaller things. And that's, journalism is a lot about that, choosing an anecdote or an example, and then using it to illustrate a bigger point.
How do you think we're doing in Canada compared to the rest of the world when it comes to, you know, communication as a country and, you know, response to this pandemic?
Well, that's an example of where you have to break it down by region, right? So it's really different. BC has distinguished itself as being the communications leader. You know, you have Dr. Bonnie Henry. She's become sort of this public idol almost. And she's really shown how you communicate properly. And you have at the other end of the spectrum, Ontario, not so great on the communication, really struggling. The messages are muddled and mixed, and it's not clear who's in charge. So you have to make those distinctions. And so how are we doing overall? Not bad, but not doing great in the two big provinces, unfortunately. If you look at us globally, and you know we're a global, you can get on the computer and read anything in the world. Globally, unfortunately, we're kind of batting above our weight. Canada's always in the top 15 countries most affected. And if you look at population, we're about the 40th most populous country in the world. So we have way more COVID proportionally than we should have. And that's unfortunate. And it's really unfortunate because we started fairly late, right? So that we had the advantage of knowing what was going on elsewhere in Asia, in parts of Europe, and we were still pretty slow to react. And I think a lot of that is the Canadian, you know, there's a lot of good things about the Canadian approach to life. We're pretty mellow, we're pretty cautious, but in this case, it didn't serve us well. We've acted very incrementally, very slowly, very cautiously. And we know in retrospect, the countries that are doing best in the world are the ones that did stuff. They didn't necessarily do the right stuff, but they acted really quickly and they took action. And that's, I think there's a big lesson there for future pandemics. I wrote the other day, it's better to be fast and half wrong than slow and half wrong. And Canada, unfortunately, is in the slow and half wrong category. Nobody got this right overall, and we're never going to, but it's better to act quickly.
Right. So when you say act quickly, you mean we could have like closed our borders earlier. We could have, you know, stopped flights from coming in or whatever it might be. That's what you're talking about, those reactions.
Yeah. And I think, you know, in particular, closing the border to the US, I think was much more important than closing the international border in retrospect again. But we could have done that quickly. I think our shutdowns, our lockdowns were very, very timid. You know, when European countries shut down, they shut down. Like I saw pictures of Italy, and if you went on the street, bang, you had a fine. In Canada, it was like, well, don't go out unless you want to go out. And, you know, we kind of a little too mellow for our own good at the beginning of this, I think.
Yeah, and it's interesting. I find it interesting that you say that because a lot of people feel the same way as you. But then you see these reactions of some who, you know, are saying that, you know, we're losing our freedoms because we're in lockdown. I'm like, here in BC, we are not locked down. Like, there's no lockdown. Like, we have not lost any freedoms. Like, wearing a mask is okay. It's interesting how even the tiniest hint at that really makes some people uncomfortable that, you know, we should close this and we should do that. It's fascinating to watch how this pandemic is shown a lot of cracks, don't you think, in who some of us are?
It showed some cracks, but I think it showed the difficulty of being in public health because everybody has a different risk tolerance. So you're speaking to the broad public and you say one thing, you say a simple phrase, you know, the epidemic curve is rising. And half the population is going to freak out and the other half is going to go, oh, so that means nothing, right? So it's really, really difficult to communicate these broad public health issues to a very diverse population. So it's always going to be a challenge.
Now, let's talk about the mask for a second, because, you know, there's a lot of people that don't have a problem wearing a mask and it's not a big deal. And there's a lot of people who apparently have a big problem wearing a mask. Dr. Tam has, you know, again, a scientist going on scientific information, communicating it to the country. Each province is different. Is that where we kind of lose some people? Is in our, you know, our national message and then our provincial message is kind of different sometimes, and just about masks in particular.
Yeah, masks is a real sore point for people. I get a lot of blowback on that, and it's a hard one. But, you know, if you take the example of Dr. Tam, so she's criticized a lot because she changed her position. And I find that a very odd response. I think a scientist who adapts to changing social norms, to changing science, that's exactly what we want, right? So to criticize someone for not being rigid strikes me as very rigid. So I found that strange. Masks are also one of those things that it's very simple on the surface, but actually quite complicated. like many simplistic solutions, it's not that simple. So my big worry about masks is not, you know, I've said all along, if you want to wear a mask, wear one. All the power to you. There's not really a downside to it, except there is a downside. And the downside is people take it as a silver bullet. So people wear masks and then, well, I don't have to social distance, or I'm going to go to three stores instead of one because I feel safer. So there's all these social consequences. You know, oh, any idiot can wear a mask, right? I get emails saying that all the time, but it's not true. It's actually fairly complicated. They teach courses in medical school on how to don and doff a mask because the little details matter. You can infect yourself more than you otherwise would. So all these seemingly simple things are actually complex. And that's, again, hard to communicate. And when you talk about that, people feel insulted. Oh, you're saying I'm stupid. No. I'm saying that this is not as simple as it looks on the surface.
Mm. You know, when we look at racism around COVID-19 and, you know, messages that are or just names and, you know, even the name of the virus, right? And watching that be directed at Dr. Tam, a scientist, and other people in this country. It's been. Have you been surprised? I mean, you wrote about AIDS, and so you know there was a lot of discrimination. I mean, an enormous amount is and still is around that virus. So with this one, I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I wish I was surprised, but I wasn't surprised in the least. It's existed during the pandemic, you know, during the Black Plague, people were discriminated against in the Middle Ages. It's something in human nature. We look for people to blame. So you have to understand the psychology of it. So you always want to blame someone. That's why we have anti-Semitism. That's why we have racism. People always want to blame someone for their misfortune or their fear. So natural response. So I think, again, it's a challenge of communicating to people, listen, that, you know, yes, the first epicenter was Wuhan, but that doesn't mean people who look Chinese are going to be more, you know, there's all these prejudices that maybe the media fuels them a little bit, but I think just people cling on to them as some kind of life raft. I want an explanation for this. And that's true of, you know, we have lots of quackery and stuff these days on the internet, all these magical cures. And that's all it is. It's all people longing for something. You know, I want this to be over. And it's understandable, but you have to work against that and try and counter it as much as you can.
I mean, I guess we see it with most medical conditions, you know, like with cancer, right? If you say you have cancer, you will get, and I know this from experience, inundated with, you know, you should be drinking carrot juice, only carrot juice because it does this, or you should be eating apricot kernels or something, or this horse oil or whatever it might be. And it's right. I want it to be over. And I just think it's fascinating. And social media has really, I mean, it's just such a bizarre experience to be experiencing a pandemic, first of all, and then to be experiencing it through the eyes of social media that so many people are, right? There are, you know, millions of people around the world that are watching this unfold on social media, and it's quite the thing to watch. So yeah. I can't imagine you are a seasoned journalist who, this is your beat. You write about health. And you are the facts, you know, you are the facts. And so you write facts. My point is, do you ever get attacked on social media for being biased, for being, not telling the truth or anything like that? Or?
Oh, absolutely. Nonstop. You know, the fake news business, you know, I think that hydroxychloroquine is the cure and you say it's not, how dare you? It's relentless. So I think the social media, you have to learn to not only have a thick skin, but to sort of take it with a grain of salt to understand. Again, I'm a big fan of history, of medical history. So you understand that these movements, this minority of loud people has always existed, right? It existed when the first vaccination came along with Jenner. There were huge protests against vaccination, even though it was one of the greatest advances in scientific history. And they're exactly the same arguments 300 years later. And you kind of go, they're going to be right with it forever. So I don't worry about people on the margins who are sort of out there too much.
I guess you're right. It's been happening for hundreds of years, except now those people have a phone.
Yeah, they have a much bigger megaphone. And yes. I think the other thing is, unfortunately, I think in the general public, there's a lot of doubt. We live in skeptical times. We live in tense times. So people are, I worry more about the skeptics than the anti anything. So especially, I read a lot about vaccination. And I think the most important group is the parents who are well-meaning and skeptical, and they kind of say, I've never seen measles. Why would I give my kid this poison, right? I'm old enough that I've had all these diseases. You don't have to convince me about vaccination. I had all these horrible things as a child. But a lot of us are spoiled. A lot of people are spoiled. They've never seen this, and they want the best for their children. It's all understandable, but we have to communicate better that this is a reality of whether it's showing them pictures of smallpox or whatever. Unfortunately, lots of people are getting education because measles is coming back and mumps is coming back. But that's a pretty harsh way to teach people this lesson.
Yeah, it comes down to privilege, right? It always is privilege. We are very privileged that we have.
Yeah, as someone who's traveled, written in Africa, when you see a mother who's walked 3 days to get her kids immunized because she understands, that she's already had a baby who's died of measles. She'll go do anything in the world to save her other children. You see that, and it's really moving. And then you come home and you see somebody at Whole Foods saying, I wouldn't, put poison in my child's body. You think that is about privilege.
Mm-hmm. 100%. When it comes to long-term care facilities, I mean, we have to talk about this, and you write about it. I have a child with a disability, which is what always draws me to you because, some of my friends I know are like Isabel Jordan and Sue Robbins, and, I know you know them too. And you are, to somebody like me, a parent of a child with a disability, I look to you for that voice, right? That voice that is helping me learn as a parent, but also, hopefully engaging others to understand, right? Something that is really hard to understand if you don't live it. Long-term care facilities, we're talking all the time about these long-term care facilities, COVID outbreaks there. Seniors, we know that most seniors have disabilities that are in these long-term care facilities. There are people with disabilities living in these care facilities right across the country. And I mean, why are people so surprised that some people are not receiving excellent care in these facilities now?
Yeah, I think they're surprised because they just don't know, right? It's ignorance. And in the true sense of that term, it's not disparaging, but it's just lack of knowledge, I think, a lot of it. And I think also on that issue of, frail seniors, people with dementia, kids with disabilities, it's all really the same issue. And I've been lucky over the years, very early on in my career, to meet a lot of parents of children with severe disabilities and to learn a lot from them. And what they teach you is that if you can't care for the most needy, if you fail them, you fail everyone. That's the reality. So to me, that's what our social safety net, that's what our health system is about. It's making sure that nobody's left by the curb. And that's why I write about these populations often, because I think they're so important. They inform all our care across the board. And I think that's the story with long-term care to me, is we've just decided that we have a group of citizens that don't matter anymore. They're disposable. Let's just stick them off somewhere. I think, sadly, we've just put people somewhere to die rather than put them somewhere to be cared for. And that fundamental approach has to change. It's existed for 20 years or more, and we have to address it. And this pandemic, if any good is to come out of this, is that we're going to blow up that system and start from scratch. And everything that applies to these seniors applies to kids with disabilities. It's the same issues.
It is. I guess you know, I don't know if I have a lot of faith that, I guess what for me, it's upsetting because I think, well, this has been, we have sent away people with disabilities for over 100 years, like institutions, right? And Ontario is a real leader in that, you know what I mean? And not in a good way. And now we're seeing these long-term care facilities in Ontario and BC, and it's everywhere. And I agree with everything you said, but I'm not sure that we might want to change it, but that's not going to come cheap.
Yeah, I don't think money, I hope money's not an issue.
Well, it always is though.
Yeah, but we spend a lot of money delivering bad care. We can spend a lot of money delivering better care. I think that's the issue. I don't think money is a big, big factor in this. I think it's a philosophical issue. I think we have to, you know, what we have now is ministries of nursing homes, and we should have ministries of care, of elder care. We have to think about, I often do speeches. I do lots of speeches. And one of the things I always do at my talks, and if I'm talking anything related to the elderly or people with disabilities, I always say, let's do a show of hands. Who would like to live in a long-term care home? Nobody ever raises their hand. I even spoke to a group of long-term care facility owners, and they didn't raise their hand, right? So why are people being sent there? No one wants to go there. Now, the reality is some people will need institutional care, but none of it should be delivered the way it is now. We can do it in smaller facilities. We can do it with better staffing ratios. We can make it a philosophical and political priority to say people are going to age in place. We're going to keep them at home as much as humanly possible. Countries do this. Countries like Denmark, the Netherlands, they don't have these big, awful institutions, and they didn't have thousands of deaths. It's a direct result of our failed public policies that we are killing people, and we have to talk about it in those terms.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you 100%. I guess I feel a lot of I just feel so much disappointment when I read and when I see, and because I know this information. I volunteered when I was a kid in extended long-term facilities, and I know what I saw then. How do we make people care? Like, well, I think that's such a huge part of it, right? How do we make other people care enough?
I think the way we try to make them care in journalism is we try to personalize them, right? That's why we use anecdote. That's why you use stories. The reality about long-term care, about elder care, is we're all going there, right? We're not getting any younger. We're an old society age-wise. So I think we have to make a decision of how do we want to live? I think that's what the big societal question that emerges out of this is, how do we treat our elders? And the answer to that question is badly. We treat them abysmally. And this is the proof, and we can change it. Now, you're quite right. It's easy to be skeptical and even cynical about this, especially I can't tell you how many reports I've written about how we should improve care for the elderly. When the last round was when a nurse became a serial killer in Ontario. And I thought, well, after that, you know, if you can get away with murder, literally, and she would have never been caught had she not confessed. If you can get away with murder, there's some pretty fundamental problems, right? I wrote about fires where dozens and dozens of people burned to death because no one could get them out. And I thought, people are not going to tolerate this. So it's easy to be cynical. And it's also easy to be cynical when we look at what happened with mental health. So in mental health, we had this great awakening in the 1960s. We closed down all these horrific institutions, but we discharged people into nothing. Right? We didn't replace them with other kinds of community care. And the result is today we see it on our streets every single day. You have thousands of people sleeping on the streets of Vancouver. Why? Because they don't have mental health care. You know, these things are all, we know what happens. That's not a surprise. So it's easy to be cynical and say it's not going to get fixed. But I, even though I'm a journalist, I try to be hopeful.
I try sometimes. So hard. I try very hard to be hopeful also. With long-term care facilities, do you think there's a difference between private and, are private long-term care facilities a bad thing? Like we hear a lot that, these are bad.
Yeah, I think it's very dangerous to bring the debate down to something so simplistic. There's a lot of good private homes. There's some bad private homes. There's a lot of bad public homes. There's some bad, good public homes. So if you bring it down to that simplistic a notion, I think we're going to get ourselves, we're never going to solve this. I think the issue has to be, let's make sure there are standards. Let's make sure that care is affordable. Let's make sure that people who work there want to work there and they have good conditions. That can happen in any number of payment models. And that's, if we get stuck on that, in that dogmatic private bad, public good, that's not true. And if you want to back it up with data, in Quebec, actually, the vast majority of deaths in long-term care are in public homes. Because there are very few private homes in the province. So it's not a magical solution. So I always get caution about that black and white solutions. Well,
and that's what we see sometimes when we are, you know, just reading headlines. It's like, oh, you know, the government sold all these public homes to private, and now look what's happened. It's like, well, not really. Let's, you know, dig in a bit more. But yeah, it's very interesting how I could talk to you for hours just about long-term care facilities. But I do want to ask about, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, you have to remember too, when you say, oh, private care is bad, you have to remember why we have it. And the reason we have it is because governments refuse to spend on infrastructure. Why do they refuse to spend on infrastructure? Because the public is not tolerant of governments having debt. So they flob off their mortgages to private providers, and then they pay them back and pay with interest. So that it's ultimately our fault, right? If we want no private providers, we have to be willing to have debt, just like we have mortgages in our home. So when we have these arguments, we have to have them fully, is what I hope.
Exactly. What about all these bailouts with COVID-19? How are you feeling about we're hearing a lot of bailouts. I'm still waiting for people with disabilities, but I'll just keep waiting.
Yeah, so I think actually the single most important health measure that's come out of COVID-19 is the government providing income support. I think that's really, you know, it's reminded us that the single most important thing for our health is having an income, having a roof over our heads. That's what matters ultimately, more than medicine, more than all this other stuff, being able to shop, you know, going a whole month without shopping. That's terrible, but it doesn't matter if you don't have an income, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that those income support programs that governments have brought in, federally especially, but provincially as well, I think they're really, really important. Now, that's the positive. Now, the negative is I think there are far too many corporate bailouts and not enough bailouts of individuals. To me, support should go to people, and the people should spend their money supporting whatever they want, corporations. So when, to me, you shouldn't be giving billions of dollars to an Air Canada, which has assets which are worth money and they can rebuild their company. Yeah, they suffered, you know, shareholders suffered a little bit. Too bad. That's the risk that goes along with being a shareholder and being in business. But individuals are the ones you really have to prop up. And you have to give not equal support to people. You have to give equitable support. Some people need more support. People living in care, people with disabilities, people with mental health, with mental illness. So you have to adapt these programs to individuals. So I'd like to see a lot more focus on that, on people. And getting people back up on their feet and working rather than just bailing out corporations kind of willy-nilly. And to be fair, in Canada, we're a lot smarter about this than in the U.S. In the U.S., the bailouts for COVID-19 are a boondoggle for billionaires. We have to be frank about that.
What about, you know, we're seeing, for example, here in BC, people with disabilities getting an extra $300 a month, we could talk for hours about that, but I'll just use as an example. When COVID-19 is over, or there's a vaccination, or it's, you know, time has run out on this extra $300 a month, what, we just take it away and we go back to the way it was?
Well, I think that's going to be one of the big challenges, right? So any number of examples, bolstering a bit for people with disabilities, the $4 an hour raise that we gave our personal support workers, will that be permanent? It better be. But I think a lot of this discussion is going to come when we stop talking a little less about the illness. I think those will be really interesting economic discussions. Another positive coming out of this is I think we're really looking seriously at the issue of basic income, right? So the federal bailout, that's essentially what it is, $2,000 a month for most people. That's a basic income. So if we're doing it now, why not do it? If it works now, why wouldn't it work later? And you're seeing, we're seeing countries, I was reading about Spain is looking seriously at making this permanent, their basic income. So I think they're always good. There's always good that comes out of these crises. A lot of great things came out of the Great Depression because they created social programs for the first time and they became permanent. So what's permanent fixes? What benefits are going to come out of this? Hopefully that'll be one of them.
Mm-hmm.
But so it's also a reminder of, you know, how little we give people, support people in the first place. And hopefully that's part of the discussion.
I really hope it is. Do you think that COVID is it worthy of all this news hype that we have? It's like COVID-19 all the time. And I mean, should we be talking about it this much in the media?
Well, I think we always sort of go overboard. That's part of the nature of the beast in a way. But I think it really is a once in a century event, right? I don't think you can underplay. A lot of people now are saying, oh, it wasn't that bad, but it's not over, right? We're in the, if you lose a baseball analogy, we're kind of in the first inning, maybe the second if we're lucky, but there's a long way to go. Again, I was rereading a book that I love called The Great Influenza, because I think we can learn a lot
from the
pandemic. And, you know, in 1918, the first wave was bad, but it wasn't that bad. People went about their lives again. And the second wave was really, really devastating. It was way worse. So I think we're not out of the woods with this. It doesn't mean we're going to repeat 1918. The world's different. But yeah, maybe we're going overboard, but I'd rather we write too much about it than be complacent. And my biggest worry these days is I think people are like, yeah, that's done. Yeah, let's move on.
Yeah, well, it's summer and it's all okay. And yeah, we talk so much about the second wave. And I think you're right that people just, there's a risk involved, right? With just overload of information. And it makes you just want to kind of turn it off and focus on something else. I really think that COVID-19 has shown how important our news media is.
Well, I'd like to think so. I think, you know, we have unprecedented readership, but we have no income, right? So actually this pandemic is going to be devastating for the media. A lot of media properties are just simply not going to survive. We've already lost about 100 community papers in Canada in the last 4 months because of this. There is no advertising revenue. People demand that, you know, all our COVID coverage is still not behind a paywall. It's all free. And people think that's another problem with the internet. People think everything's magically free.
Right.
And it is, but only to a certain extent. Once there's no media doing the digging for other things, for other people to steal and put online for free, what's going to happen, right? So
exactly.
I'm always perplexed by the people who say, oh, the mainstream media sucks, it should die. Say, okay, maybe it sucks, but what's going to replace it? It's not going to be better, right?
Exactly. Yeah,
so people, we have to find a way of monetizing information. It has to be affordable, has to be accessible, but it also has to be able to pay for itself so that we can be these watchdogs that we're supposed to be.
Yeah, and I mean, in a lot of ways, the genie's out of the bottle, right? Because when the internet was first allowing us to access this information, it was free. And now, like the Globe and Mail, for example, my friend Gary Mason, every time somebody comments on one of his tweets and they say paywall, he always tweets back and says pay for journalism. And people are offended by that. But it's like, well, the reporter needs to be paid. It needs to, like, there's so much that needs to happen in order for this to be accessible for people. And it's not like it's outrageously expensive.
Yeah, and I'm very much like Gary. I don't have any tolerance for people complaining about paywalls. My glib answer is always, do you complain about the coffee paywall at Starbucks? Because nothing's free, right? People pay their Netflix and they don't want to pay for the newspaper. I just don't get it. But as you mentioned, the genie's out of the bottle. I think the media has to take some of the blame for giving away its product for a long time. They were very arrogant. We used to be hyper profitable when these young kids and their internet thing came along. And I remember that. I'm from the pre-internet era. The newspaper owners were very, oh, sure, we'll give you our content. Here you go, kids. Have fun. And now they're running the show, right? Facebook, Twitter, to a lesser extent. But I think people, if we're in a world where there's only Facebook and there's no Globe and Mail, there's no CBC, I think people will very much regret that. As much as they may hate the mainstream media, I hope they don't only appreciate it when it's not there anymore, but I think it's in big, big trouble.
I think it's in trouble too, but I hope it never goes away because there is so much value in it. And I think that, you know, we're seeing that now more than ever, to be able to go and read an article, a well-researched article, or watch a report that you know is fair. I hope that this shines a light on how important it is, especially local media. I need to know what's happening in my city, in my province, in my country. And
yeah, local media was doing relatively well until this, and this has been a real death blow to much of the local media, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. What is your biggest worry right now?
I think my biggest worry, COVID related, is about complacency. That we just say, yeah, done, been there, done that, move on. You know, I think we have to get on with life. I don't think the lockdown should be forever. But I think we really have to figure out how to live with the virus rather than just being fearful of it. And it's finding that balance, about finding new ways of how do we shop? How do we work? How do we go to school? And I think we have to take these as an opportunity to do things better and not just take them as, this is going to be temporary. You know, we're going to send the kids in the class for a 15 for a few months, and then we'll get back to our cramming 40 into a class. I hope we don't do that stuff. I hope we actually learn and benefit from some of the changes forced on us.
I hope you're right. And non-COVID-19, what in health is on your mind?
Well, I'm watching. I'm actually very interested in the Black Lives Matter protests. I think they're a real reminder again of what I mentioned before, how, you know, the social determinants are so important to our health. I think this discussion about the health impacts of racism is way overdue. I was just writing before we were talking, I was filing my story for tomorrow talking about this, how I think, you know, people are saying, oh, we have to stop the protests because we're going to have more COVID. But I don't believe that. I think we have to say, listen, there's sometimes a price to pay for improving society. This has happened for really awful reasons, but it's happening now. Maybe the timing's bad, but too bad. We have to encourage these protests. We have to answer the call of the protests to fix inequalities. And this is as good a time as any to do it. If we get a few hundred or a few thousand more infections as a result, well, too bad. To me, that's a price worth paying for a more just society.
André, you are a Canadian gem. You really are. You can read André in the Globe and Mail. You can follow him on Twitter. You are, what's your Twitter handle again, André?
Picard on health.
And I love how active you are on Twitter and the information that you put out. It is, you are a nice voice for a lot of us. And so I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to me today. And I look forward to reading your future columns. So thank you so much, André. I really appreciate it.
Well, it was a pleasure. It was nice talking to you, and stay well.
I will. You stay well too. And be sure to join us here on TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart every week.